Everyone stay where you are. We'll do the count here.
Where's Sheila?
I haven't seen her since before work unit.
Miss Miles, I think we're all here except for Sheila.
So where the fuck is she?
Oh, how should I know?
Sit down.
Maybe she's in the slot.
She's not in the fucking slot. Sheila's dead.
What?
I killed the fucking bitch because she murdered Rev.
Sit down, Kelly!
What the fuck?
You are so fucking useless. You did nothing! You did nothing! None of you did fucking anything! So I am declaring myself top dog!
Well, there's a dramatic opening to tonight's Tuesday chat. Welcome back. Lovely to see you again, Kate.
Hello, good to see you too. It's very early here.
Mm. Well, it's very late here. Different from when we chatted 18 months ago. And we had to be quite careful about what we were saying because you hadn't actually appeared on screen at that point. Now we've seen Lou Kelly in all her glory.
Yeah, full flaming Lou. You've seen it all.
Almost. Three to go. Yeah. What sort of feedback have you had from the audience?
I mean, you know, it's been mostly pretty great. I think that she's kind of roused a certain amount of terror and joy and, you know, it's been really different. And people are so passionate about the show and they, you know, so you get kind of great love and you get great hate, but that's kind of fun as well because it's obviously a character that's gonna stir some kind of response in you, so you know, middle of the road is less interesting, but there's been some pretty dramatic swings to either way.
She is certainly a character that you love to hate, you know, that cliche, the JR cliche of being the villain you actually find really charismatic as well. And I remember the first time we chatted about 18 months ago, you said that for you the humor of the character was very important, as well as the violence.
Yeah. Well, I think, I mean, Lou's got such a dark sense of humour, and I think when finding characters, finding what makes them funny is such a great way into understanding their psychology. And Lou's humour is just a bit off the charts. I mean, I think she's fairly fearless and macabre, and I think she finds joy where other people perhaps wouldn't, and satisfaction in actions that other people probably wouldn't. But I really appreciate her humor. I think she's just so like childish. She's that annoying little shit at the back of the classroom that you just want to shut up, but at the same time, maybe you might want to hang out with every now and then. Yeah.
So that opening scene that we've just watched, how is it for you to watch yourself back?
I mean, that was a pretty rough week for Lou Kelly. And it was an exhausting week as an actor. You know, it was an exhausting week of work, but it was pretty thrilling as well. I mean, we knew from the very beginning that it was leading to what happened at the beginning of this season. And so the kind of commitment to building that love story, knowing that it's going to end so tragically in the way that it did was part of the fun of the creation of it, I think. And yeah, that whole kind of those weeks of filming after Reb's death were pretty extraordinary. But you know, it's the kind of stuff that you love doing as an actor because you throw your whole body and heart and soul into it. And at the end of the day, you're completely knackered. And that's a nice feeling as well. But yeah, that day I remember just remember the adrenaline being massive and kind of having to rush off between takes and just like, whoo, just kind of open a window and get the cold air in and then come back and start again. And Yeah, but it was great. I mean, all of the background artists who work in Wentworth are so phenomenal, and the attention that they give you, and kind of they, you know, the cast and all the background artists, that kind of what's going to happen next, what's she going to do, you know, there's a real great commitment to making it something massive, which is really fun and a total honor as an actor when people put that kind of trust in you to just let rip. Yeah, so
you're right, because obviously Lou and US Lou are center stage. That's your massive moment. But you can feel the tension coming from everybody else, the looks, the looks between everyone. And I only just noticed when we just showed it there, is I love the sound effect of Smile's feet clipping on the floor as she runs panic to the door.
Good luck, Smile. I'll just rein this in. Yeah, yeah. I know. It's so good. Yeah, they're very, very clever. And I think, I mean, Lou obviously loves an audience. Lou's, you know, fairly happy to be a bit of a ringmaster and feels comfortable in that space where she's holding court. You know, obviously this is different than a moment of great entertainment and razzle dazzle. But I think it takes such a great bunch of humans around you to also commit to that as well. Otherwise you just feel, you know, you're just kind of shouting in a mall and nobody's listening. But when everybody kind of commits to making it something special, it's great. Yeah. So, yeah.
And, you know, your voice at the end there's a real passionate, heartfelt screech in your voice.
Yeah.
But as a performer, you must be conscious of when you're going to give that delivery, because you don't want to peak too early, because you're going to do multiple takes, I assume.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, at that point, yeah, we do multiple takes, and they're between the director and the DP, they're really good at letting you know that, you know, where this is the bit that they're probably going to use with. But I think in something like that, you never know whether it's going to be its best kind of moment in a massive wide or in a close up. So you kind of really have to go the whole way. But they're also really aware of conserving their performers' energies as well in big emotional things like that. So there's a lot of preparation done, so they know, they're pretty clear on what the shots are going to be and get it done as kind of effectively as possible to kind of save your energy. But also some days like that, it's just fun to wreck yourself, you know, to just go, this is it. This is the bit where it all goes up in flames and just throw yourself at it. And, you know, a few lozenges after and you're okay. Yeah.
Do you surprise yourself sometimes in some of the scenes? Do you go further than you actually expected to or planned to?
All the time, which is really fun. Yeah. In an environment where you feel safe, that's the thrill of it, is walking away having surprised yourself at what you committed to, which is so dependent on the actors that you're working opposite and how safe you feel and how committed you all are to the story that you're telling. And if that commitment is massive, then you always surprise yourself. I mean, obviously there's days where you feel like, yep, okay, I did my job, or I wish I'd done my job a bit better. But the days that you want the most of it, where you walk away going, whew, I didn't know, oh, that came out, oh, great, you know. I think that thing of kind of doing enough preparation and homework to then on the day be able to just let it fly a bit and see what happens, yeah.
Well, it's certainly been a season of surprises so far, and will continue to be, I assume.
Yeah.
But the one that actually I think had my jaw drop was the end of last week, at the very end, when Mari and Lou actually get together. I didn't see that coming. How manipulative.
Yeah, I mean, when Susie and I got those scripts, got the heads up on that storyline, both of us were just like, I beg your pardon. Sorry. Sorry, what? Sorry, what? What down there, Susie? What up there? How are we going to make this work? What's going to happen? But I think also because it came, we got the script straight off the back of, you know, Reb's death as well. And you're like, how is this even going to happen? How is, like, how can we kind of, how is that going to work with that storyline? And but we, it was a really fascinating thing to get our head around. I found it, you know, in terms of what you do in moments of grief and who you reach to in moments of grief. And even though the relationship between Lou and Mari has been terrible, there is something in Lou that knows that that connection between Mari and Reb was real, because Lou was terrified of it. And Lou kind of, Lou despised Mari for that connection. But I suppose with Reb gone, in Mari, Lou sees somebody who had great love for him. And I think they can grieve together with their tongues down each other's throat. Yeah. What a way to grieve. I mean, don't they say funerals? You get kind of, you know, grief does funny things to one's chemistry. Yeah.
Yeah, you know. Rebound times 100.
Yeah, really. Yeah, that's right.
In the intense confined environment that is a prison, is Wentworth.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. I mean, you know, Lou is a character who, on the surface, is strong and bold, but you've also beautifully brought out the character's vulnerability. Has it been fun playing that aspect of the character?
Yeah, it has been really fun doing that. I mean, I think, yeah, you get to see Lou alone so much. I mean, even, you know, before Reb died, you really got to see the public, private face of Lou, that she is one person when she's out there holding fort, and she's somebody else when she's in the privacy and safety with somebody that she loves. And then when she loses that person, the kind of just utter smashing heartbreak of that. And you just, yeah, you see, I think that loneliness just really... the loneliness and the grief is so massive. And Lou, I just don't think Lou, I think Lou's just grasping for anything to live for now. Which clearly at the moment is revenge. I mean, there's such a childlike quality to Lou as well. I think when I was trying to find her, I spent a lot of time imagining what she would have been like as a kid, because so many of her emotions are really stuck in that place of like of tantrum and massive grief and, you know, big laughs, and she swings a lot, and just trying to work out the kind of things that maybe stunted her a little bit when she was a kid. And I think when you can see the kid in a character that you're creating, it's, it can be easier to access that that vulnerability, because, you know, Lou was once a little 5-year-old running around.
Yeah, oh, that's a really interesting take on it. No, I like that. And ties in actually that several weeks ago we spoke to Katrina, and she was saying that the two of you got together and talked about Lou and Boomer's backstory, because you obviously knew each other from the past.
Yeah. Yeah, that was so much fun. I mean, Katrina's just such a beast of the screen, you know. She loves the art form so much, and we had so much fun. Because we knew so little except for that we knew each other and that we'd been in prison together before, and there were indications in those first few episodes of a history that we'd had. And so Kat and I just went, well, let's just make it up. And so we kind of wrote emails to each other before we started the show about all the things that we might have done together as kids and the things, the shit we would have pulled, and when we came to each other for defence. And there's this place in just outside of Melbourne called Frankston, which can be a bit rough, and we kind of imagine that we grew up in that place. And we had an imaginary group of friends that Kat and I kind of worked out, and we talked about boyfriends that we had or girlfriends that we had, and it was really fun. And whilst none of this ends up being scripted or in the series, just when Kat and I are playing together, we have this history that we've invented that just sits in you and adds to, I suppose, the depth of what you're playing, because there's a past there that you can see. You're acting with Kat on something, and you can see a glimpse of them as a teenager kind of throwing a shit bomb at somebody's front door, you know, like, so it was really fun to do. And it just an absolute dream to act with Kat. She's just divine.
Yeah.
We had a lot of fun together.
We talked a moment ago about the romantic, say, relationship. I'm not sure if romantic is quite the right term for Lou and Mari. But of course, we saw tonight at the end that flipped and you literally struck out. How was it doing that confrontation with her in the garden?
Really fun. Yeah, really fun. I think also, you know, for Lou, like, Lou has very, I mean, Lou trusts Mullet. And that's about it, I think. And Mari, I mean, I don't think Lou ever trusted Mari, but I think Lou's also feeling incredibly stupid for having let that part of herself be exposed in front of somebody who is so clearly so manipulative. And so I think there's deep shame there for Lou, which automatically turns into anger and fury. And yeah, but it was nice. We knew that this little relationship was going to be short. We didn't quite know how it was going to end, but yeah. I mean, this working out the stunt work of how to kind of slap somebody when you're of such different sizes is always quite interesting as well. There was a lot of takes. I was like, oh, over your head. Oh, got it went down. But, you know, it was a really fun scene to shoot. All of those
were really fun. We have a question here from Amanda, who says that she'd love to have seen Lou in the prison a few seasons earlier. I think actually I know what your response is going to be, asking any actor this question, but would you like to have joined the show earlier?
You know, I mean, of course, I would have loved to live in Lou's story a little bit longer. She was just such a fun character to inhabit, and of course it would have been nice to kind of live in her a bit. But also I just also had the privilege of joining a show that was so loved and so well crafted, and so it was also a privilege to kind of jump on a machine that was so well oiled and had so many good people attached to it. So,
and had you seen much of the series before? Because obviously you're busy working yourself. Had you had an opportunity to watch them?
Yeah, I had seen it. I'd seen the first two seasons, and then sporadically I'd seen other, you know, episodes throughout that. And then once I got the role, I did a big binge watch, which is exhausting and traumatizing. It's like, look, what do I sign myself up for? Yeah.
Yeah. How long did it take you to do seven seasons?
Oh, years. No. I mean, it was a few months, yeah. I mean, there's a point where you have to go to bed, and also I have small children, so you don't want too much of that Wentworth world kind of infiltrating your everything. Yeah.
No.
You've got to,
I assume they haven't been able to watch you in this particular show.
Imagine, oh, God. Yeah, we did have, when the show shut down, over COVID, over lockdown in Melbourne, we did have to do all that. We changed and did all of our episode Zoom readings instead of getting in the room together and reading the script. And I was like talking to the production office. I'm like, wait, so I cannot read this script out loud from home. Like, I just, not only do I not want to, yeah. Mind you, my daughter had a dream about her finger getting cut off. So there must have been, and this was really early on when we were shooting, and I was like, oh, God, there must be something coming in. I must be rehearsing a little too loudly somewhere. I was like, yeah, really need to keep it out, yeah.
Well, as you've just mentioned that scene, I think we should talk about that was the first, your first episode, wasn't it? The beginning of season 8.
Yeah.
My vision pop here, look, here you go, and
hey!
There you go. Hey! It's like magic, it's like magic. So how was it doing the finger scene?
Just as simple as that, really. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It was one of the very first scenes I shot, if not the first scene, actually. And it's amazing, kind of like, you know, I just remember being face down on this table looking up at all these brilliant actors who I've loved, and me being like a total Lou, being just a total fucking smart ass and just feeling like, oh, this is no way to make new friends at a new job. Like, I was just like, oh my God, I just wanted to push myself in the face for what a pain in the ass Lou was being. And I was like, okay. And so after every take, I was like, I just trying to be overly kind of friendly because I was like, wow, what a pain in the butt character to have to work with. But it was so fun. The makeup team did an extraordinary job with the finger in it. It was disgusting. And there was a whole, like, the scene actually shot a lot longer. There was writhing on the floor. There was blood pissing out. You know, they kind of condensed it in the end. So, the actual shoot day was a lot bloodier than that. It was, but really fun. And just fun to start with a scene where you go, this is where Lou stands. Like, I would rather lose my finger than do anything you tell me to do, you know? So it's nice kind of going, this is what you're dealing with from the beginning. Yeah.
So full on. Now, I'm sorry, I didn't make a note of the name, but there was a question earlier from someone who was asking, who from Wentworth's history would you like to go head to head with? A top dog that you haven't actually been able to fight in the show.
I fear they'd all beat me. So I don't know. I think there would be something kind of, I mean, of course you want to go up against Dan, you know, Dan and I've worked together before on Rake and we've had so much fun together. So I think we could have, you know, had a nice little shiv in the laundry room. I mean, I think that would probably have been pretty fun. Yeah. Jax, that'd be all right.
Well, I suppose Lou was there at the time and, you know, yeah, had been top dog. So Jax must have proposed her.
Yeah.
At some point. Sure. There must be a backstory there.
Oh, I didn't put that in my diary. Oh.
There we go.
You're right.
Now, in tonight's episode, you got to enact the classic steam press moment with Joan or Kath's hand under the steam press. What is your steam press technique? Because I know that's an important factor when working on Wentworth.
Yeah. Well, that one was a two-hander, I believe, if I remember it rightly. I think a lot of our, I've been very one-handed up until this point in anything that we've done, in all the kind of promos that we've done, it's been very much, you know, a one-handed steam press. I mean, it just leaves you available to do lots of other things with your other hand, which is good. You know, you never know when you're going to need it. So, yeah, it's been one-handed. It's been slow. It's been steamy. I mean, the steam machines there are kind of epic. You feel like you're in a Western kind of coming out of it. Yeah, so no, it's been one-handed, I believe, yeah.
So what have your been, start the sentence again, what have your favourite scenes been to film so far?
I mean, the very first week was really fun. We did the finger chopping scene, but we also did all the stunts with the cars, which was so terrifying. Yeah. And that was really fun, doing some stuff outside of the prison. I love giving Jane Hall shit. So a lot of the Anne scenes are really fun, kind of coming up in her face and tearing her down. I think one of my total favorites was the scene in the shower, the second shower scene with Boomer, where I threatened to cut off her finger with the cigar cutter. We had a lot of fun doing that. That was just like, Lou was at her ultimate kind of asshole.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The way she manipulates Boomer is so clever.
It's that real kind of, it's just so schoolyard. Like, it's really like, hey, come on, we can do this. We can be friends. So it's kind of, it's vicious. It's vicious. I think there's obviously whatever happened between Boomer and Lou really cut Lou pretty bad, and so she's a, you know, she's really able to dish out the punishment there, I think. But also really enjoys Boomer's company. I think that's the thing with Lou. Lou just loves Boomer's company. Unfortunately, she has to go down constantly, but she does enjoy being around her.
Well, Rachel's just asked, who is your favourite character from Wentworth and why?
Hi, Rachel.
Other than Lou, obviously. God.
That's a really hard question. I mean, I'm just a Boomer fan, you know. Like, I think that that character is absolutely priceless. And I think that knowing Kat and knowing Boomer and the worlds apart that they are, just seeing what she created in that character and just somebody who can be such muscle and such vulnerability and really kind of emotionally wise at the same time as kind of really grappling to get her head around certain things and her loyalty, and she's just funny. Yeah. So I think I'd probably join the squillions who would say Boomer.
Okay. Yeah. I would just ask you about a massive scene in the last episode, not the one we've just seen, but previous week, where, of course, you're water torturing Judy Bryant.
Of course.
In the skip full of water. Yes. How was that filmed? Because, you know, these things aren't filmed quickly. How long did she have to spend in that water?
Yeah, that was a full day one. So that was so much fun to see, to shoot. And also Viv was so up for it. Like, Viv was having a, you know, was really into it as well, was excited that the day was there and was just, I mean, it's really fun to do that stuff. When you know it's all being done safely, obviously, that kind of, it's epic. And there were two, so there was the actual garbage bin filled with water and crap, and then there was also another pool that they filmed in as well. So we were only there for the garbage stuff. But it was just really fun. Again, it was a real, like, ringleader, just being able to kind of sit up on the bin and, you know, take charge and just have the whole, the whole crew and the cast were just so excited about it. And I don't know, it was really fun. And we hadn't done that before, you know. That's the good thing with going. It was a new kind of death. It was a new, didn't end in a death, but it was a new, it was completely new. And actually that wasn't originally written, and they ended up changing. I can't remember what the actual way that the torture was going to happen, but it wasn't that. And then they came up with this out of necessity, and it turned out to be just absolutely brilliant. I think that was one of the good things about COVID as well. We had to change locations. Things that were once going to be in quite small places ended up having to expand. And so the writers had to think of just new ways to reimagine stuff. And that was one of the ones that came out of that, which was really, really fun.
You said that Viv was looking forward to it. Did she get to wear a wetsuit or a dry suit? Or was she just bunged in?
No, she had stuff underneath. It was cold, Yeah, but no, she had, she was protected. And the water wasn't freezing. The water was, you know, a little bit warm.
Yeah, I'd hoped so when I was watching it back. I hope they've warmed up a bit for her. Now, you did mention earlier about that opening scene of season 8, the robbery followed by the car crash, which was very, epic. What were the practicalities of filming that scene?
Well, I had to constantly remind Zoe that they're not allowed to run that fast because they're a lot younger than me and I need to look like I know what I'm doing, so they need to slow down a bit. I was like, wait, back! I'm meant to be the butch one, babe. Just let me go forward. But no, we did a lot of stunt work with the cars. That was the first week of rehearsal, the very first day I got into work. I had stunt rehearsals for a big fight, and then I spent about 2 hours in the back lot of the prison just doing donuts and hooning around, and which was really fun. And I think I really threw myself into it. I'm a fine driver. I wouldn't say I'm a great driver, but I'm okay. I'm terrified of speed though, but I think I was more terrified of looking like I wasn't gonna, you know, suit the world of Wentworth. So I went really hard on the stunt rehearsals. And then when we actually got to the day of shooting, that whole driving was obviously not in a massive lot. It was down a tiny laneway. It was reversing and going forward. It was terrifying. I'm actually amazed that we came out of it okay. Obviously the stunties took over at certain points, but there was a lot that they just assumed I could do. And I was like, well, I mean, your assumption turned out to be right, but I think that was just luck. Yeah, it was just luck that we came out of that one, okay? But they mounted, once you get in there, they mounted cameras on the car, and, you know, so your vision is, it's extraordinary. It's an extraordinary thing to do. It's, the adrenaline was massive. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It was really fun to meet the parking inspector. That was fun. Yeah.
Yeah, reversing towards him at high speed. Now, yeah. Una has a question. How was it to film Sheila's killing?
Mm. Yeah, Marta did a really phenomenal job in that. Yeah, it was both, I can't remember what your words were, but it was both of those things. It was disgusting and terrifying, but it was also fun. I think also for that point with Lou, she's kind of, she's so certain of what her action needs to be, and she's so dissociated from any of Sheila's pain or pleading, because she's just a dead woman standing in front of her who did the most vile thing possible in Lou's book. And so there's no emotion attached to it, really. The decision is made and you're going down, and I will sit here and watch it until the very end, knowing absolutely without any shadow of a doubt that this is the way that it's meant to go. And this is in a way, I feel like she probably feels Sheila got off a bit easy. But I think that Marta did a phenomenal job. And so having to kind of keep that cool of like, none of this shit is rubbing off on me, whilst watching Marta, you know, froth at the mouth was and whack their head against that basin, and it was kind of terrifying. It was also the last day we had Marta, I think, before the borders closed, so Marta could get back to her home before she got locked out of her hometown. So there was this kind of mad pressure on it as well to, you know, die slowly but quickly.
Now, we are nearly at the end. And we'll go soon. But if I don't ask you about this scene, I think I'll get complaints. Reb's death, waking up and finding Reb dead next to Lou. What can you tell us about filming that moment?
I mean, yeah, it was a pretty heartbreaking day of shooting, obviously, because of the investment that we all had in that storyline and in that love story, that was a long, painful day. I think we'd rehearsed it quite a lot beforehand, that one, because we knew that we just needed to kind of get the mechanics of the scene down without getting too emotional with it, because once you start something like that, it's hard to go in kind of halfway. You're in it, you know. It hurt. You know, but it's also, that's good, because you feel like you've created some characters that mean something to you and that meant something to the world of the show. And I listened to a lot of really, really bad Daggy music that day to kind of keep me in it, which now on reflection, knowing that the Soundies would have listened to as well, I'm mortified of that, because it was so, the music was not Butch at all. It was very un-Lou Kelly. But yeah, it was just trying to really stay in it. But I think also because as a cast, you're also saying goodbye to an actor that you've worked with. And so there's just there's a nice kind of precious energy around it, where everybody is giving it the space and the grace and that it deserves. So it was a special day as well. Yeah.
Yes. Lindsay here is just saying that as a viewer, you felt a pain in those scenes, and you really did. It was spectacular. Well done. It was superb.
Thank you. And I apologise to everyone for the snot that came out of my nose in that scene. Yeah. I mean, nobody's really said anything to me, and I respect that, because I think, thank you, thanks for just letting that go. But it's okay. I know, and it's okay that I know that you know that there was massive snot coming out of my nose at that point, which is unfortunate. But, you know, look, it is what it is.
As there would be in that moment. It's real snot. It's real emotion.
Grief snot. Now, Kate would never do that. That is not in my repertoire. Lou Kelly, however, whew, yeah, she got some sinus stuff, you know?
Have you ever seen the opening scene of a movie, Truly, Madly, Deeply? British movie about 20 years ago. Oh, it's not just pouring. I can't remember the actress's name now.
Okay. Well, it was not on that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Madly and deeply.
Now, before I let you go, I just want to say that 18 months ago, when Screen Star were lucky enough to come over to Australia, Kate Jenkinson gave us a tour of the studio, and we bumped into you in one of the corridors, myself, Ben, and Lee. And I said to you at the time that the original Lou Kelly was my all-time favourite prisoner character.
Yeah.
And then I said, so don't screw it up.
Yeah.
I've just got to say, you really didn't. You've knocked it out of the box. It's been spectacular.
Thank you.
Love the new Lou equally as much as the original.
Didn't screw it up. I'm happy
about it. Didn't screw it up.
Thank you.
Well, thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you, Kate.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye-bye. Take care.